the Lord, full of grace and full of truth. Oh, you never change. Oh,
welcome to Now Church. We are about to begin. Please take this opportunity to pull out your smartphone so you can like, share, and check in on our social media platforms, including Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. And please use the hashtag NowChurch. Thank you, and enjoy today's service.
Church, you become the church. But the church isn't the building. The church is the vision. The church is the people. The church is the gathering. It doesn't matter if we have stained glass or not. We're not looking for religious symbolism. We're looking for spiritual substance that's found only in Christ Jesus. The substance is that we're giving a place for a gathering for His presence to come and connect with real people with real problems and situations on a real journey that just have a sincere heart to move along and get to know God better. That's what church life is about. We are Now Church, building a relevant, creative church, empowering people to reach others. Not just empowered for yourself, but empowered to go love somebody that was unlovable. Thousands of people have come onto this property, into this auditorium, and have experienced a life-changing touch from God. But we believe that our best days are still ahead of us, not behind us. In order to keep doing that, you can't rest on what you've accomplished. Why are we still looking for the best days? Because we're not enthralled with our past as much as we are captivated by our future. Now Church has never been stronger, more focused, more united around our common mission, vision, and values. By God's grace, we are healthy, and we're poised for the future.
through working it all for our good. Can I ask you a question? How many of you have seen God be faithful in your life? Come on, you ought to give him a little bit more praise than that, because he's so good. You know, I was telling the team earlier, if we switch our flow, this is going to be our last gathering before Thanksgiving. And I'm so thankful. I'm going to be getting on a plane sometime tomorrow. I'll get to see my mama. Yeah, get to see the family, get to hang out. Yeah, man. She's literally been asking me every day for a week. Hey, you still coming? Yep, I'm coming, Mom. Yep, you come? Yep, I'm coming. I'll be there. Excited about it. But I just was so mindful of how good God has been to us. And through transitions, through seasons, through all the stuff that life presents to us, we've watched him walk us through scenario, health, finances, relationship. Come on, man. Am I the only one he's walked us through? I mean, he's just been so faithful. And I know that his mercy and his goodness is extended to all generations, and he's not going to stop. He's never failed, and he is not going to start now. Say that with me. Say, Jesus, you've never failed, and you are not going to start now. I've seen you move mountains, and I believe that you're still in the miracle-working business. Come on, if you believe that, for these next several moments, give him one more big praise in the house. Yeah. But I mean, for this next bit, I want you just to let yourself be lost in the presence of God. Come on, we're going to worship him today. Your voices and worship him. He's been faithful time and time again. Yeah. Walking around these walls, I thought by now they fall, but you will never fail me. Yeah. That's your testimony today. Woo. Waiting for change to come, knowing the battle's won. For you will never fail me. Voice, come on, everybody say it.
Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never failed me. Yeah.
Our God is faithful, yes, he is.
The night won't last. Your word will come to pass. My heart will sing your praise again.
Yeah.
Jesus, you're still.
Still stand. celebrate the goodness of God. Here we go. Somebody needs this, so I'm not in a big hurry. Just stay in that moment. You can even keep your eyes closed and just reflect on His goodness today. Reflect on His mercy, yeah, yeah, yeah. Thankful for You, Jesus. Thankful for You, Jesus, yeah. You never fail, start now, yeah, yeah. Sing it one last time. Your promise. Say, Your promise. Worship Him. He's right here today. Yeah. Come on, Fitz. That's right. with one voice. Christ is.
Christ is my firm foundation, the rock on which I stand, when everything around me is shaking. I've never been more glad that I put my faith in Jesus. He's never let me down. He's faithful through generations. So
I've still got joy in chaos.
I've got peace that makes no sense. And I won't be going under. I'm not held by my own strength, but I built my life on Jesus.
Yes, I have.
Cause he's never let me down. He's faithful.
Could you throw those hands up all over the building? Every hand. this moment of gratitude. Oh, keep them high. So throw my hands, praise you again and again. Come on. 'Cause all that I have is a hallelujah. Yeah. Hallelujah. Sing it, church. And I know it's not much, but I'm nothing else fit for my King, except for this heart singing hallelujah. With them still high, join them team, say, oh, say, oh, oh, in thanksgiving, say, oh.
Worship moment for a second. I got a verse here for you, and it is exactly what we're doing at this moment. It says, you can pass through his open gates. This is Psalms 100. You can pass through his open gates with the password of praise. Come right in to his presence with thanksgiving. There's a password, and you can come right in. Praise and thanksgiving. And here we are just worshiping and talking about a place where you can be unshakable. His kingdom is unshakable. You can be sitting around this Thanksgiving dinner later this week, and you can have some friends or some relatives, and they may be going on their thing about what's going on in their life and old politics and this and that. Oh, what's the world coming to? And you can be sitting there with joy on your face because you have entered an unshakable kingdom. That's the determination that we're not going to be shaken or thrown off by outside exterior temporal circumstances, because our God is greater. But you do need to enter that place. We do need to enter that place. So just again, if somehow you missed it up to this point, I want you to raise your hands. If somehow you didn't, somehow you missed that unshakable, that what was in the worship just a moment ago, I feel like we're just kind of like kicking the door open and keeping it open for you. Keep it open. Come on in. Use your password. And let's enter with praise and thanksgiving. My God, you are so good. So good to us. Lord, so good. Thank you for that kingdom that's unshakable. Thank you that we don't have to move by fear and intimidation. We don't have to worry about tomorrow. Lord, because you are there, you are present, you are a provider. Lord, thank you that you are a healer. We give you praise that we don't have to be fearful of physical issues. You are our healer. Lord, you are a provider of every good thing. Lord, and we thank you that there is reward for those that press into you. Lord, that follow you, that seek you out. Lord, and we invite you with all of our praise and all of our thanksgiving, we invite you, come. We come into your presence. Come into our lives completely, Lord. In the name of Jesus, bring that unshakable kingdom right into the midst of our life. Bring it right in now. In the name of Jesus, and we give you praise today in Jesus' name. Come on, let's praise him. Real big, come on. Come on, real big, real big. He's worthy. Woo. Man, I feel that. So I just want to encourage you as we're moving into this Thanksgiving time and you're sitting around the table and you see, if you see them start going in that direction, just sit there and smile. Just smile like you know something they don't know. And then they're just going to be drawn in. Why are you so happy? Well, I'm just not shaken. I'm good. You should be good too. Turn that into worship. That is awesome. All right. Well, listen, we've got a lot of stuff happening here at Now Church, and so we have some stuff to share with you on the screen. So I want you to turn around, smile at somebody real big around you, give them like a, you know, a fist bump or something if you want, and then sit down because we've got some stuff to show you in a minute. Yes, yes, yes. All right. Well, it is good to have you in the house of God. And of course, this whole week we've been having different stuff that's been taking place. And so we've got some stuff to share with you. Of course, this last Sunday evening, we had a youth event and then we had a church-wide prayer event that was awesome and communion and awesome time. But we want to highlight right now, we've got some pictures of the In the Know. We've got some stuff happening with the youth that happened with pie and prayer. That sounds like it's a pretty good combination. Pie and prayer. So they had a good time getting together, having a little bit of sweets. I think that's a good way to approach prayer. Have some good sweets and then get right in there and pray. It's awesome. So anyway, it's got some fun stuff that happened there. How many know that church ought to be a lot of fun too, right? It's full of life. And again, just thank God for our youth and we're enjoying these times. And so then right afterwards, of course, we had our communion prayer time, had a great crowd here. And we had some good stuff that we shared with you, some vision and just prayed and just thank God. Communion was powerful. So it was amazing. And then, of course, on Thursday, we had our ladies gathered together for their Bible study. This was the third of a three meeting series, three generations. It was awesome. And so they all gathered together. Let me hear from the ladies. It was awesome. Yep. That was even during the day and those that were available and could work around their schedules and all that stuff. So they came in, had a really great time. And then they decided to go out and party, had ladies, let's do lunch over at La Bella's. And so all the ladies gathered together. You got a picture of that? Yeah, awesome. And so the owners of La Bella's opened up the restaurant just for our ladies, and they took over and just had an incredible feast there and a great time together. So you listen, so many things that are happening at Now Church, you never want to miss it. For the guys that are getting hungry right now, we have La Bella's coming up for us too in December 17th, save the date. Anyway, so it's all good. But listen, we're so glad that all of you have come here to Now Church. I know, listen, I just heard this morning from someone that is in our Now crew serving now, and she was just giving God praise for finding this church. Isn't that awesome? For finding this place. And it warmed my heart, and just, you know, they're realizing they had prayed. They had prayed, and they'd heard a message. I hope I'm getting this right. They'd heard a message on the radio, someone encouraging them about when you find the right church, you find a place to fit, to belong, and that your giftedness finds an expression. And I love that. I love that. So maybe this is your first time checking out Now Church. And so we want to make sure that you feel welcome and encouraged. And so right after this, there's going to be a welcome card out front. If you just go by there, we have some gifts for you just to celebrate your coming and thank you that you came and chose this church for your Sunday service. And so we're glad. But check this out. We also challenge you. We don't just give you gifts. We challenge you from the very first experience. It's called 3-Week Challenge. Just check out Now Church 3 weeks in a row and see what God does. Yes? So that's that whole purpose, that whole point the lady was just talking about. She did that. And then she connected. And now she's serving in here. And she's a great blessing, her and her husband. So I'm just giving them an anonymous shout out right now. It's awesome. All right. So one more thing now. We've got some great stuff happening. Pastor Richard has an incredible word. We're continuing on in this series of faith. Are you ready? Come on. Let's welcome our pastor up.
Thank you, sir. Doesn't Pastor Chris look sharp in his Jordans today? He's got his black and purple Now Church Jordans. Anyway, we're just glad that you're here today. Before I get into the message, just a couple things we want to do. First of all, our dear friends, the Stewart family, this is their last Sunday with us for a while. We are their home church, but we supported Jesus Way Ministries last few years in Jamaica as this family has been missionaries. Yvonne grew up in our church, And they got married in our church, and then they moved away and found their calling and destiny in missions. Well, the last few weeks, and I want to say this very carefully, because right now you can't say the word transition without somebody thinking something weird. So they're in transition, but not the way they say on the news. Okay? So the Stewart family, would you guys just stand up right where you are? Russell, you can stand up too, and Raymond, you can stand up too, if Roger's here anywhere. So this family has sensed a season, a shift from Jamaica, left, they built a tremendous ministry down there and released it to all the people they raised up. And now they have felt a lifelong dream that it's time to bring it forth. They are beginning a youth ranch in Tennessee. And it's going to help all kinds of young people, all kinds of situations. I want you to know we are adding our amen, and we supported them, and we will continue to support them as a church. So we want to pray for them today. Everybody stretch your hands toward the Stewart family as they pursue Jesus Way Ranch. Father, we thank you for committed missionaries. Thank you, Lord, for their calling, their identity in you, their strength in you. And Lord, today, as a congregation, we add our blessing and our amen as they move into this next season of changes. And Lord, we ask you just to guide them in this 1,000-acre ranch. Thank you for your provision for the land, your provision for the buildings, your provision for them to stay in the right places as they build. Lord, we thank you for bringing the young people from around the country and around the world that will begin to be helped in this ministry. We thank you for them. We pray safety. We pray protection. We pray provision. And we thank you, Lord, for their willingness to say yes. And today we add our amen in Jesus' name. And everyone said amen. Amen. God bless you guys. Give them a good hand clap. Thank you, guys. I'm sure we'll see you from time to time, because we're holding your family hostage. Anyway, no, because they're still here. Anyway, one other thing before we get into the message is, earlier in the year, we did a couple things for couples. And we did a couples, like, weekend, and it was just tremendous. And we said we're going to work on something. Well, Pastor Kristen Kennedy has been working since August on a couples date night for the holidays. And we just finally got confirmation it's coming to pass. We just got confirmation Thursday. We should announce it earlier, but mark this down in your calendar. 2 weeks from today, December the 4th. Can you believe 2 weeks from today is December the 4th already? Anyway, 2 weeks from today, we have rented the Marion Theater downtown for a private party where we're going to show a classic movie. We're going to have couples get together. There's going to be childcare here at the church if you need it. And so we want to provide that for those of you that have kids. And they're allowing us to bring in pizza with us. And there's going to be all kinds of other surprises and fun. What's that? Pizza and cake. They're allowing us to bring in the rest we got to buy there. But anyway, everything, it's going to be awesome. We're going to be on the marquee down there. It's going to be a wonderful night for couples to get out, get away, and be together. Married couples, we just want to invite you. Other couples, we still want to invite you. It's going to be a great time together. Don't miss it. So put that on your calendar. And how do they start signing up? Today you need to pay. Oh, so it's not free. Anyway, so a good couple's date night. Listen, a couple's night at the movies right now can run $50 to $75 if you buy popcorn and everything else. This is pizza for two, cake, movie, downtown, $30 per couple. Okay? So we want to make that affordable for everybody. Please sign up today. Pay your money today. Get your reservation today. We need to know pretty quickly how many can come. Like I said, wish we could announce it earlier, but we just finally got confirmation that it's coming to pass. And we have the downstairs theater, correct? The bigger theater. So they have two levels there if you've never been to Marion Theater. Anyway, get excited about it. This is a great time. Men, ask your wives out for a date. Don't assume. Or as we said last week, presume. Don't presume. That's not faith. Okay? You need to ask like a gentleman. and then set it up and make it a nice evening, and you'll thank me later. Anyway, okay. So today we're going to get right into the message, our next series, our next part of the series on faith that moves mountains. Today's message is called Victorious Power. And I'm telling you, I feel power in the room already, even during praise and worship. Praise God. 1 John chapter 5, verse 4 is where we're going to start from the Passion Translation, a great paraphrase. It says this, "You see, every child of God overcomes the world." I could just stop right there and just preach for a little bit. Every child of God. Are you part of every? Are you part of, are you the exception to the rule? God can't do it for you? No. You are part of every. You see, every child of God overcomes the world, for our faith is the victorious power that triumphs over the world. So who are the world conquerors defeating its power? Those who believe that Jesus is the Son of God. This is the victorious power. This is our faith. I want to weave in 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 12 from two different translations. New King James says this, "Fight the good fight of faith. Lay hold on eternal life, to which you were also called and have confessed the good confession." You've said the right things in agreement with God in the presence of many witnesses. I like it from the Message. It says this, "Run hard and fast in the faith." This is not wimpy language. This is aggressive language. Run hard and fast in the faith. Seize the eternal life, the life you were called to, the life you so fervently embraced in the presence of so many witnesses. You got to go after the life God has promised you by faith. Say amen. Let's pray one more time. Father, open the eyes of our heart that we can understand. Take hold of your word. Let the spirit of faith in this place envelop us to step out and to believe you for signs and wonders and miracles in seeing lives changed and seeing our community blessed in Jesus' name. Amen. If you get a chance to watch so far or listen, please watch online to the previous messages, because we're building on a foundation here. And there's so much. When I think about the subject of faith, I always go into it thinking, oh, this is going to be a nice series, and I love to study this stuff. The problem is when you actually start getting curious about a certain subject in the Word, and you start leaning into it, the more you see, the more you see. The more you look, the more you want to look. And so I could do a whole year on faith and still not really scratch the surface, because it's the key to everything that we access in God. And we're going to talk about it today a little bit more. We live in a time where there's so many challenges to simply keeping and growing in our faith. But remember this, faith itself is such a dynamic force. I love Jude chapter 3 from the Message. Jude writes, "I have to write insisting and begging that you fight with everything you have in you for this faith entrusted to us as a gift to guard and to cherish." Your faith is a gift, and you have to guard it and cherish it and nurture it and grow it. You're responsible to build it up, to build yourself on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost, as we said a couple of weeks ago. This Bible faith is more than head knowledge. Well, I call it college knowledge. College is great, but college didn't give me what's inside my spirit. Leaning into the Word of God, the inerrant, the inspired, the infallible Word of God. That God doesn't make mistakes. He didn't say anything wrong. If we don't see it, it's because we don't see it correctly. It's because we're not there yet. But God is working on your behalf. But we need more than head knowledge. We need deeper, stronger, heart-emanating knowledge. We need revelation knowledge. We need God to turn the light on in our hearts that we can grab things with the core of our being. Because when you have Bible faith, something goes off inside of you. It's not a, oh yes, I think I see that. Well, you can see that till you're blue in the face, but if you're not activated and moving forward in something, you're just trapped in your head, and you're not really living strong in your spirit. Because faith is a spiritual force. It's a dynamic force. Faith is not just a belief system or a belief there is a God. Or let me just say for those of you who may be newer, faith is not believing in a higher power. It's believing that Jesus Christ is the one and only Son of the living God. Amen. And that kind of faith overcomes the world. You overcome by faith. It is the victory. In other words, when you're believing, when you're trusting, when you're holding on to God, and you're still believing, even though everything else around you is saying something different, you already won. You already have the victory. Just keep stepping. Just keep moving forward because you're trusting God. You don't have to understand everything. You don't have to know everything. You have to trust Him and believe Him. Faith endures and perseveres through challenges and disappointments. You say, Pastor, you ever been believed God for something and been disappointed that didn't come to pass like you thought and when you thought? Yeah, how much time do you have? If I stopped trusting God because I got disappointed, I'd have never made it out of sea spot run in the Bible. Well, that's not in the Bible, but you know what I mean. Some of you didn't grow up with Hooked on Phonics, so you don't even know who Spot is. But anyway, the bottom line is that we move forward and we trust Him, and when we get hit or disappointed, it's not because God messed up. It's because we didn't see the interpretation correctly, or most of the time, it's a timing issue. It's a timing issue. And so you just have to adjust your time and say, okay, God, my times are in your hands. You're the author and finisher of our faith. So you wrote the book, and you're going to finish what you promised in our faith. But do we get disappointed? Yeah, that's what Paul the Apostle said. Cast down, but not forsaken. You know, shipwrecked, but still swimming. You know, we're still believing God. We overcome by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of our testimony. And we overcome by still trusting in Him and doubling down on that fact that we trust in Him when all the odds are against us. Man, I feel the spirit of faith here today. When circumstances are screaming at you and you have to stand up in faith and speak and agree with God's word, you have already won. Just keep believing. Just persevere. One of the great texts in the New Testament that I love is in Mark chapter 5 when Jairus, an important leader of the local synagogue, whose daughter was so sick she was about to die, he humbled himself before Jesus. The Bible said he came, even though he wasn't necessarily, if he was a believer, he was a secret believer, but he knew that his daughter was dying and he was desperate. And out of that desperation, he did something that maybe the other people in the synagogue would have been pretty offended by. He went and worshiped Jesus. He bowed down and he pleaded with him to come to his house and heal his daughter. Mark chapter 5 verse 22 said this: behold, one of the rulers of the synagogue came. He was a leader. He was a synagogue leader. This is an important guy, Jairus by name. And when he saw him, he fell at his feet and he begged him earnestly, saying, my little daughter lies at the point of death. Listen to this language. Come and lay your hands on her, that she may be healed, and she will live. She will live. This guy, he might have been trapped in a religious fragment of society at that moment, but at that moment, it didn't matter. At that moment, he is in a desperate situation, and he comes to Jesus in worship, in praising him in advance, and then he says what he believes. I believe if you come to our house and you lay your hands on my sick daughter, she will live. How many know that's faith language? He's believing there. He's accessing. He's going. The Bible says, verse 24, so Jesus went with them. Doesn't say Jesus questioned. Doesn't say Jesus made a big speech. Jesus went with the man who stood with him in faith. And you think, oh, that's a great story. No, that's not the end of the story. And the Bible says a great multitude followed him and thronged him. That means they threw their throngs at him. No, that's not what this is. They thronged him. My friends, sometimes when you look at something, you read it 1,000 times, you have to look at it again. So I like to do little word studies and look in different translations. One thing I did, I just took a peek at Strong's Concordance to see what the name Jairus means. Jairus, his name means whom God enlightens. Or in other words, the one who gets a revelation. Jairus had a revelation in his desperate time. Now, had his daughter not gotten sick, we don't know. Jairus would have just kept going as the religious leader and telling other people, don't go to Jesus. He's claiming to be the Son of God, and that's blasphemy. In this moment of desperation, he does something in actual faith according to his enlightenment. One whom God enlightens. Isn't that a great thought? Boy, I want to be Jairus. I want to be that way. I want to be enlightened like that. So, the Amplified says, when it says thronged him, doesn't say thonged him, it says they pressed him, Amplified says, pressed him from all sides as if to suffocate him. In other words, that this is a big deal, that the crowd is pressing in to where you ever been in a concert and everybody's trying to get close to the front of the stage? A few years ago, Pastor Julian Melfi, I was in London, and he took me to one of those outdoor festivals in London to see Aerosmith. And he said, look, we're going to position ourselves right here, but he said, we're going to work our way up to the front. I said, okay, I'm in. These guys are 100 years old, but I like them. That's good. I just say, walk this way, and I'm with you. Just don't give me a kiss. But anyway, so we're kind of working our way up, and then we could only get certain distance. And what we didn't see was that there was a long runway from the stage that came only about 5 feet from us. So we're trying to make our friend the stage. We're still back 40, 50 feet. We're like, oh, this is it. All of a sudden, during the concert, Steven Tyler comes running down this runway, and he's standing right there. And it just kind of freaks you out when you're like, oh. See, when you're pressing in, man, when the crowds, I'm telling you, you could hardly breathe. And that's when you really hope that there's no emergencies. That's how people get hurt. Well, this is the kind of scene when Jairus and Jesus are walking to go to his house. And many of you know the story. In the middle of the chaos, a woman with aggressive, risk-taking faith herself pressed through that crowd, got on her hands and knees, and touched the hem of his garment, looking for healing for herself. And power flowed out of him, even though he didn't even really know what was going on at the time in his humanness, but the anointing flowed. The anointing moved, and this woman was completely healed. And Jesus stopped and said, who touched me? In a crowd like that, they're pressing him enough to suffocate him. And they Peter, James, and John are with him and said, Jesus, everybody touched you. Who didn't touch you? That's the question. He said, no. Somebody touched me with a different expectation, a different attitude, a different something. And I felt, one translation says virtue. I felt power. I felt power go out from me. Who is that person? Now, this woman, because of her condition, wasn't allowed out of the house by law. Under the Old Testament law, she wasn't allowed out of the house. And if she touched people, it's maybe a death sentence. It's definitely a death sentence if she touches a rabbi. She is, you talking about risky business? She is taking a risk. If she identifies herself now, she may be arrested. She may be thrown into prison. She may be instantly taken out of the city and stoned to death. But in faith, she says, it was me. And Jesus stopped and ministered to her and said, lady, your faith has made you well. Now go your way and be whole like that. Be well. Live in what you're expecting. Live in what you're believing for. Now that's all a great story, except Jairus. Jairus is now standing there thinking, what is going on? I remember when we were working with Pastor Benny Hinn, there were times he was moving prophetically. A couple of times he said something, you know, Richard and Gail, and he'd call me and my wife out, and I just stand right there, I'll have a word for you. And then something would happen, and somebody would touch him, or he'd get another prophetic unction, and he's over here, and then he turns back, and he completely forgets why we're standing there. And we would go home like, well, what was that? We got called out. He has a word, and we never got it. And it's so disappointing. You just feel like, I mean, we went home a couple times, kind of dejected, and like, it almost felt like God rejected us. But it, you know, it wasn't. But you know what I'm saying? It was like, well, that was a missed appointment. We needed a word. We needed a thought. We needed something to encourage us to keep moving forward. And he was about to give it, and I got nothing. But God never is distracted. And he never has a purpose. Sometimes the purpose is how you react to the disappointment. Sometimes that is the purpose. Sometimes that is it. So, as they're standing there, and this whole scene moves with this lady, the lady's completely healed. I'm sure Jairus is thinking, that's great, lady. Get out of the way. He said, go home. And while they're standing there, some of the people from Jairus' house run up to him and said, too late. Leave the master alone. Leave the rabbi alone. It's too late. She's already dead. Come with us. Now you got a choice. Now you have a choice to make. Because Jesus knows instantly what's going on in the situation. He turns to Jairus and says, don't be afraid or fear not. Just believe. Only believe. Fear not. Don't let fear. So, in other words, there's something moving. Fear is moving. Somebody said fear is like faith in reverse. Fear is like putting faith in what the devil is saying, what the enemy's doing to your brain. Fear is that activation point. Faith and fear cannot exist together. They cannot inhabit the same space. So at that moment, the ultimate disappointment is your daughter's already dead, too late. And Jesus says, don't let that thing take your head away from what I already told you and what you already said you believed in your heart. You already said, if I come to your house, lay my hands on your daughter, she shall live. Right? That's what you already said that. This release of anointing along the road did not stop that. Neither did the news that she's already dead stop that. Just only believe. Just believe. Just trust God. Trust me, Jesus said. He said, trust me, I've still got this. That's my paraphrase. Trust me, I've still got this. And I think that's a word for somebody here today. It doesn't matter what it looks like. It doesn't matter what anybody's saying. It doesn't matter what the circumstances say. And it doesn't, let me tell you one thing. It certainly doesn't matter when somebody says, too late for God. Too late. God can't do this one now. Too late. That is a lie from the pit of hell. Too late is not in God's vocabulary. It's never too late for God. You might be in a situation where you passed a deadline of something, or a big bill came due, or whatever else, and you're going like, well, they're saying it's too late. Are you telling me it's too late to trust God? Do you actually believe that the creator of the universe is bound by your calendar or by your bill collector? No. And listen, I'm not making excuse. Do not make excuses to pay bills late by saying, well, God's going to take care of it. It's not late. No. If you have it within your ability, you take care of it. That's the point. That's integrity. Okay? That's virtue. That's integrity. You do the right thing. But if you get down to that last minute, you know, they talk about the 11th hour. God is sometimes at 12:15. It's past midnight. And he's still God. And you can't imagine, I've said it many times before, that in our few years of preparation for ministry back in the 80s, we went through some very, very dark times financially. Very dark, stretch times. But we call it now our faith walk time. In the middle of it, we tried to call it faith walk time. We wanted to call it this is stupid. This hurts time. But faith walk time, God came through time and time again. But here's the thing. Once somebody gave us a holy handshake and put like a $50 to $100 bill in our hands, and then the next week I wanted to shake everybody's hand. One time during that time, by the way, the apartment God opened up for us at the time was at Lake Destiny. So they're like, okay, you're still with us. Well, then we got an unexpected blessing in the mail. Well, I wanted to hug the mailman every day when he came by. And you know, so I went by, look into the mailbox every day, because that's how he did it last time. God is not going to be bound and limited by what he just did. So Jairus is processing all this. He got the worst. Think about this. The worst news at the worst time, I call it a gut punch. It's like, boom, just takes your breath away. You can't do anything in those moments in your own strength. Amen. Jesus, the living word, is speaking the word. Trust me. In that fear not, only believe, that word, when Jesus says believe, he's releasing power to do it. Yeah. So in that moment, all Jairus had to do was, okay, I received that. Mind is still going. Bad news is still happening. Death is still death. But the Bible says our God swallows death even up in victory. Because death isn't even the end for us. Now, as they get to that place, Jesus, the Bible says, only allowed Peter, James, and John to go the rest of the way. I thought that was interesting. If you look at the scripture, so this is the whole thing from Jairus through the woman with the issue of blood, and now Jesus says, okay, Peter, James, and John, you're the only ones coming with me. Everybody else, he got rid of the crowd. That's a big thing when you're moving in faith. Sometimes you got to get rid of what the crowd is talking about. Then Jesus approaches the house. And if you read the language, he clears the house. Almost like he did when he cleansed the temple of the money changers. Jesus cleans house. He says, okay, all y'all who are crying, out. Now that seems a little harsh. Until you understand that the customs of the day is they had professional criers. When somebody died, they had people to come just to be sad. They got paid to be sad. Jesus said, all you sad sacks, out. The word is clear. He says, Jairus, bring your wife. Peter, James, and John, you come in, everybody else goes. Now he comes in, and they said, well, you know, how can you be that way when she's dead? Jesus said to the crowd as he's walking them out the door, she's not dead, she's just asleep. They're like, what? Now he speaks to the girl, Talitha Kumai. But if you look, I was looking at the original language in some of this stuff, and basically he says, wake up. Wake up, girl. Young lady, it's time to wake up. It wasn't dramatic. I'm sure it was dramatic, but he wasn't like, Red Sea parted. You know, it wasn't like, he just said, I just told him you were asleep. And the Bible says she immediately got up and walked around. She had him walked around with him. She hung out with Jesus. On your worst days, just don't let the fear take over your brain and put you in distress. Trust him. Faith at its core is trusting him when it's hard. Choosing trust, choosing to believe God in the middle of distractions and interruptions and other people. His faith could have been, Jesus gets loaded up for a miracle and then he releases a miracle. Well, on the way to his miracle, he released a miracle. Maybe he doesn't have another miracle in him right now. Maybe he's got to reload. We don't know what he's thinking. But if his brain is going like, well, she took my miracle. She took mine. Now you're really in trouble, because now you're into jealousy, envy, strife. And the Bible says that's where every demonic work is. Now you're comparing yourself with somebody else. Fear not. Fear not. Don't be afraid. Just believe. Just believe. Just trust God. Just believe. And the believing part was that they just kept walking. The believing part was, I mean, Jairus, I'm sure, is like, I got to go get with my wife. Come on, let's run. No. You can't run. You can't. If he would have run ahead, he'd have found a dead daughter. This is for somebody, okay? This is not in my notes. This is in my spirit. We can run sometimes to try to hurry God toward what we're believing for. But if we get there ahead of time, it's just us, and the situation and circumstance is as bad as it is. But if I can walk with Jesus, fear not. If I could just take another step forward without that anxiety and that stress going, I gotta get the, come on, please. Could you please hurry before? Yeah, I mean, Jairus is probably looking, is there any other women gonna touch his clothes today? What else is coming? You know, he's probably like guarding Jesus like ninja, you know, making sure nobody else is gonna tell him, get the miracle again. He didn't know what was gonna happen, but his faith had been set before. Jesus had to just get him back to the faith track. Remember what you said. What did you see? What did you believe before? You're going to come to my house. If you come, lay hands on my daughter. Now, interestingly enough, the Bible doesn't say Jesus laid hands on her. He just spoke to her. He just spoke to her and said, wake up. Now, I would say here that I think where we are in the body of Christ right now in America and really throughout the world is there's so many Christians that are sleeping. Amen. And we just need the Master to wake us up. Amen. We just need that awakening, that quickening, even in the church. Can you say amen? Amen. Don't get distracted by interruptions. Jesus is undeterred. God is focused on everything at once, carrying victorious power is both a privilege and a responsibility. The word privilege is defined as a special advantage given by honor or birthright. It's a privilege. We're children of the King. But it comes with a responsibility. The word responsibility means the state of accountability or bestowing a sense of duty for a task. We've been given a sense of duty for the purposes of God that are ahead of us. Jesus said it this way, to whom much is given, much is required. To whom much is given, much is required. We got to get our eyes back on the purpose of faith. That when we're accessing God, it's for a purpose. When we're accessing His presence and His power, it's for a reason. And that reason is not always selfish. It's not always self-serving. In fact, it's not to be self-serving. It's to be God-serving. It's to be serving in the sense of, look, I am blessed. I've been given much in my life. But that means God's going to require much. It's not that you ever get to Easy Street, my friend. It's not that you're just trying to build up your 401k so you can sit back and do nothing. Amen. We say it this way around here. You are blessed to be a blessing. Amen. The more blessed you are, the more you have as a resource to help somebody else or other people, and not just more for yourself. We also say around here, if God can get it through you, He can get it to you. If you'll be a conduit, a wire, or if you'll be a place where God can move His power through you, you're going to have enough of His power to you and for you. But the problem is we get selfish with what God is doing, and we get out of faith. A couple more things and I'm done. Faith is a heart attitude. That's what Jairus was tested on. It's a hard attitude. It's humility mixed with confidence in God. Confidence doesn't mean arrogance. A lot of people misinterpret that. Confidence doesn't mean arrogance. If you're confident in God, it may look like arrogance at times, but it's not. It's firmly rooted in the fact that you're trusting Him to do something that you know only He can do. And it's not about the way you look or the way people think of you. When you're genuinely anointed and filled with the Holy Spirit, you don't have to prove it to anybody. You don't have to show it off. You just have to follow the promptings of the Holy Spirit, do the next thing He tells you to do. And I'll say it this way. When the enemy comes and says to Jesus, if you're really the Son of God, turn these stones into bread. Jesus spoke the word and he didn't turn stones into a snack. He was hungry, but He didn't serve Himself, so He turned and deflected, and He spoke the word and said, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. I need to hear the next thing God is saying. Yeah, man, that's right. And the next thing, and the next thing, and the next thing. And that's what helps me to move forward in faith. Jesus spoke the word in power, and you can speak the word in power as well. Finally, this faith cultivates a grateful heart. Thanksgiving shouldn't be the only time of year that we pause to express appreciation to our amazing and generous God. If you're not amazed by Him, pray God gives you your wonder back. Come to Him as a little child. Children are still in awe. Part of the loss of innocence of our children at this time in the world that's so scary to me is when we lose the innocence, we lose the wonder, we lose the awe, we lose the splendor, we lose the wow. Think about the holidays when you were a kid. Those moments when grandparents or many people that are in heaven today are gone from this earth. You can think back to those times when you heard that sound on the roof on Christmas Eve. You knew someone's coming to load up presents. Hopefully you fell asleep. Sometimes you wake up early. The rule in our house was until the sun was up, you couldn't wake anybody up. I can't say I always lived with that rule. Think about that. Oh, family gathered around Thanksgiving or Christmas. A big meal. All the food. I'm getting hungry thinking about it. Thanksgiving is not a, it's not just an event. It should be an event here where we turn our hearts toward God in that way, but it shouldn't be the only time of year we do this. Zig Ziglar always said, an attitude of gratitude determines your altitude. The way that you're going forward, the heights you reach, if you just stay grateful. Faith cultivates a grateful heart. You have to count your blessings. You have to choose in those moments when you get bad news or distracted, or somebody took your miracle, or somebody else got your word, or something happened good for somebody else, that you are believing for the same thing for you. You have to stop in those moments and say, hey, thank you, Father. You never run out of blessing. You never fail us. My friends, thankfulness is the great equalizer for true humility. Because you're dependent on God. Stay grateful. Stay thankful. Stay patient in timing. You say, oh, I don't like the word patience. I don't either. Brother Summerall used to tell us, don't ever pray for patience. God will do it anyway. Don't have to ask for it. But I want to say this as I close. To me, and this is in my experience, this is not a scripture, but it's an experience. Mountain-moving faith usually comes with a pickaxe. Meaning, that mountain usually moves one wheelbarrow at a time. It doesn't always move from here to there. There are usually things along the way that make it a project and a process. Let that mountain-moving faith work in you. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for your word today. Lord, you're so good to us. We trust in you. We believe your word and your promises. Lord, today for those that are watching at home or around or those in the room, I pray, Holy Spirit, that you would come and move in this place. Help us not to be distracted by stuff that just tries to grab our attention for a moment. Let our hearts be set on you. Our hearts be set in faith, Lord, as we are having family around this week, or we're getting to be around them. Would you help us to be the healers this week, the peacemakers, the blessors? Lord, we acknowledge that every good and perfect gift comes from you, Father, and you alone. And we say thank you. For health, for protection, for your love, for our spouse, for our family, our friends, for every good thing. Thank you for the ability to work and the jobs you've given us, the callings you've given us, Father, at this moment in time, whether people are in a job or in a career, a calling. Lord, thank you for the opportunity we have to provide our families. Thank you for your goodness. Thank you for your mercy and your grace. Help us to grow in faith. In Jesus' name. Just there, right that in that moment. Faith begins, real Bible faith starts with what we call saving faith. The moment that you passed from death to life. The moment you said that you, like Jairus, had an enlightenment, a revelation. Wait a minute. Maybe Jesus is real. Maybe the Bible is the word of God and not just an ancient book. whatever that revelation means to you, you have to do something with that moment and just say, Jesus, come into my heart. Change me, forgive me, fill me. Do something great in me. If you do that today, you're going to have the greatest miracle that can ever possibly happen. That is that you can be dead one moment spiritually and you become alive the next. Ask him into your life today in Jesus' name. Did you get anything today? I sure hope so. I hope you got something good. Come on, let's praise God. Ushers are moving right now. We're going to receive our tithes and offerings real quick. I'm going to thank you for giving. In the next few weeks, we're going to be able to show you on the screen what we've been able to do this year with continuing to give and sow and all these things. This has been a big year for what's been happening in Ukraine. Our church, I believe we're close to, well, we're over $35,000, $36,000 this year that we've given that we did not have in the budget that came through for missions or for Ukraine itself to help Pastor Valeri and Pastor Zibby, our friends there in Poland and in Ukraine. Pastor Valeri from Kharkiv, Ukraine, contacted me this week and just said, hey, thank you for all you've been doing. He said, I hate to ask, but he said, part of what he's been doing is driving people and food around and getting food to people in his community. He's been recognized by his mayor for basically pastoring a whole section of his big city. And just so thankful for him staying there in the middle of the bullets and the bombs. But he said this week they've had two vans he's been using for this whole time. And now first one, the engine died, and then another one died this week. So he's asked us to partner with him. So I'm not asking you for some specific thing. I'm just letting you know, in case you want to do something, you can just designate it for missions this week, and we'll know where it goes. But we're going to send him something this week already. If you want to help add to it, I think he said one vehicle was $2,500. It was going to cost a fix. The other is $3,000. That's a lot of money for us. It's a lot of money for them, for you. But it's a lot of things that they're doing with it. Talk about a missionary to his own city right now. So I'm just putting it out there, but in the next few weeks, we're going to be able to show you a whole screens of all the things that we're able to do, because collectively, we can make a difference when we put all of our money together and help people. And I just want to say a huge thank you for your support. You know, everything in faith works through seed time and harvest. You have a need, you pray. But in my experience, I find that what God usually does is when you have a need, God gives you a seed. And if you eat the seed and hang on to the seed trying to meet your own need, you've now missed out on the harvest that he wanted to bring to cause that thing to come to pass. Thank you for your seed. Thank you for trusting us. We take it a privilege and a responsibility to oversee. God's money's heavy money. It's holy to him. And as your leaders, we treat it that way. We're not frivolous with spending. If you only knew how we've made it through the last 15 years, you'd actually be amazed. You'd be amazed. But I want to thank you. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your blessings. Thank you. You blessed us to be a blessing to the world, to our own community, to other people. Father, thank you for the privilege of being blessed by you. And we say, yes, whatever you tell us to do, we'll do it. We'll never second guess. God, whatever you say to do, whatever you say to give, whatever you say to go or send, Lord, you were about it. We pray for Pastor Valeri and his wife and daughter. Thank you for protecting them all these months in the middle of a war. We now pray for those vehicles to be fixed, to be repaired, and we pray that whatever we can send can join with whatever somebody else can send and make it enough and more than enough, Father. to provide for them, to provide for those people in that city. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you for your giving.
Amen. As the ushers are serving you right now, I just have a few announcements again. Just wanted to remind you about the couple's date night. So that's awesome. I'm ready for a good movie and some pizza. We can't tell them which movie yet. Is that just a surprise? Oh, it's a surprise. It's a classic, so you don't want to miss that. So again, now is the time. We have that in the back, the table in the back. Becky is ready to help you back there to register today. Also, please let them know when you go back there. If you have children and you're going to need childcare that night, please let them know, because we need to know how many kids and what ages and who to expect and prepare for, okay? Also, if you attended this last Sunday evening when we gathered together for churchwide prayer, you received a ticket. And so we want to let all of you know that received the ticket that we may have something this coming weekend for you. So please be aware and check our social media posts so we can give you the date, the time, all right? So that's it. Go ahead and stand up. And just want to have someone right around you, turn around, someone right around you, just tell them, have a great Thanksgiving weekend. Bless you, and we'll see you.
Thanks for joining us at Now Church. For the latest updates, visit us at nowchurch.com, including live or on-demand video, event registration, online giving, and much more. And don't forget to follow Now Church on our social media platforms, including Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. And please use the hashtag #NowChurch. Thank you,